I'm very thankful that at the time that I grew up in association with the Lord's church and then became a Christian, that the church was much more sound in doctrine and practice than it has been most of my adult life. It was nothing unusual. In fact, it was commonplace to hear from every pulpit just about in the land of Churches of Christ that the New Testament was a divine pattern, that it was an infallible, inspired blueprint, meaning simply that it is an objective standard that does not change and the meaning of it does not depend upon whether you're male or female, old or young, rich or poor, or whatever ethnic background you have. That's what absolute objective truth is. And in my journeys later in life to different parts of the world, much of it while I've been here, I never had to be concerned about what to preach to the people because it was the same gospel anywhere in the world that I went. It was different sometimes in preaching through a translator, but that's just a matter of adjusting to the way it works. But it was still the same truth. As I spoke in English, what originally had been translated from the Greek or the Hebrew, and then it was rendered from English into whatever language it was, all things being equal and accurate, the same truth that saves men's souls was preached. And so it's always been for those who are faithful to the truth. If you look at Titus 1 and verse 9 and 2 Timothy 1 and verse 13, you'll see that Paul, as the New Testament is being written, writing to two young preachers, urges them to hold fast the form of sound words. To speak of a pattern, to speak of a form. We've done this many times in this congregation, though I fear in a great many congregations such as this is not mentioned as it ought to be. That if you are pouring concrete, you want to take on a certain form, you have a concrete form. If you're going to build a building, you have a blueprint, and so on and so forth. You make a dress, you have a dress pattern. If you're going to do anything of that nature, wanting to reproduce as accurately as you possibly can, you've got to have something to guide you. And it doesn't change. And you realize very quickly when you deviate from the pattern and you find out I measured a little wrong here and you might have to go back and do a considerable amount of changing to get it back according to the pattern. The writer of Hebrews, in striving to stop Jewish Christians from apostatizing, that is leaving the New Testament pattern, referenced Exodus 25 and 9. And he says, as Moses was admonished of God when he was about to make the tabernacle, for see, saith he, that thou make all things according to the pattern showed to thee in the mount. And the message of the Hebrews writer was, as it was said to Moses, and as Moses must do, as God required, so it is when it comes to the Lord's church and its work, its organization, its worship and the members and the kind of lives they live in it. These are good things. They're wholesome. We know where we stand with God. You think for a moment when Buddy was mentioning, and I do appreciate the prayers, when Buddy was mentioning the matter of praying for me as we prayed for others, I got to thinking, now what if the anatomy of each person on earth was totally different? Now think of what that would do to the location of your various organs. Each person, you didn't know whether the heart was going to be in the foot, or the brain in the knee, or the kidneys in the head, and we won't go there as far as what a lot of people do and how they think. But be that as it may, when that fellow the other day was going to do that kidney biopsy, he was very particular. Now, I don't know about you, but when people are going to do things to me, I like them to be particular. I like to think there was a whole lot more of those he had already done before he got to me. Not only that, he had that CT thing going, and it was this and that. He marked and he looked and he did, because he knew before he ever started where the kidney was fundamentally located. But what if it wasn't that way? Well, in the spiritual body of Jesus Christ, do you think that the last will and testament of Christ, the New Testament of Christ, the mind of Christ revealed in words of our own level, do you think it says now, faith comes by climbing a live oak tree in Spring, Texas? Faith comes by, for the folks over in England, by hearing the Word of God. People in China, faith comes by waiting in the sea for an hour. And on and on and on you could go. It's not like that. The pattern is the same. The blueprint is the same. Sameness is a great thing. We've been taught over the last many years, sameness is not good. A great many people in the church, when I was but a young man, even still in college, were doing things just different because they were doing them differently. I don't mind doing optional matters differently if they help discharge the obligation in a better way. That's fine. But just to change things because they've been done a certain way for a long time doesn't make good sense. And yet that's what a lot of people have done because they've lost all respect for absolute objective authority of any kind. You see it in our nation, not just in matters spiritual. So anything that's very old at all gets rejected. And why? Because it doesn't work well anymore? No, because it's a few years old. I like it when it's according to the pattern. God's always demanded that His pattern or His blueprint be followed in exactness. If you take going back to the patriarchal age and the Noahic flood, when it comes to the ark, which would save Noah and his family, God specified, He was particular. God specified the dimensions, the arrangement of the ark, and the material of which the ark was to be built. And what's wonderful, being that Paul said of those things in the Old Testament, they were written aforetime for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the Scriptures might have hope, is that Noah was approved of God. But when was Noah approved of God? Thus did Noah, according to all that God commanded him, so did he. Genesis 6:22. Now frankly, I would love to have that truthfully put on my tombstone regarding everything God requires of a person to believe and obey to become a Christian and live the Christian life. That's the greatest compliment you can ever give to anybody, no matter what. Noah understood that he was to make all things according to the pattern. The idea of the pattern means this is how God taught you how to do and what to do and when to do. That's all it means. It's like, and we've had it said for the last third of a century by a lot of folks who think they're highly educated, the string of degrees behind their names, and they teach in the colleges operated by loose-knit brethren, that pattern theology was just invented by the Church of Christ because they just wanted to be different. Now, what I just said that they said is as big a lie as ever been told by anybody anywhere. It's the nature of truth, and the New Testament is truth. I know that because Jesus said so. If you continue in my word, don't you know that he could just as well have said, if you continue in my pattern, if you continue in my doctrine, if you continue in the faith, as it's used in Jude 3, as a body of doctrine, then are ye my disciples indeed, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Now, is the truth concerning how to become a Christian, live the Christian life, is it vacillating and changing all the time? What would you think if a preacher, same preacher, mounted the pulpit and told you, now to be saved today, just everybody hold their hands up and look at heaven and think of God, and you're saved. Next time he got up there, he said, everybody just hold hands and look at your neighbor and say, we all love God and want him to save us, and you'll be saved. And on, different things. We don't have to worry about that. What did we sing a moment ago? Give me the Bible. The Bible doesn't change. If you have an accurate translation of the Hebrew for the Old Testament, for the most part, and the Greek, Koine Greek of the New Testament, and it's rendered into English accurately, you have the Word of God in English. If the same was rendered into Russian accurately, you have the Word of God in Russian, and so with German and Spanish and so on down the line. I do not understand why that's such a problem except for this. If I don't want to adhere to what's plainly set out in the Scriptures, the way language sets out anything to anybody for their understanding, then I've got to figure out a way to get around it. That shouldn't be new to us. If you still believe Genesis and the way that the devil approached Eve, he just plainly said, God said this, that ain't true. That's basically what it came down to. He says, thou shalt not surely die. But God said, thou shalt die if you eat of the tree, of the fruit of this tree. Seems it's rather easy to get people to change from the pattern of doctrine set out from God on this for this reason. They're looking for a way to get around it in the first place. That's what Eve was doing. She wanted to gratify the appetites of the flesh. She wanted to eat that fruit. And when you've got people who are determined to do a certain thing, no matter how plainly the Bible sets it out that you should or you shouldn't, as the case may be, you'll figure out a way to do it. What about the Lord's church again? When we look to the Old Testament, we see Moses and the Mosaic of Ages. He gives the law of Moses concerning the life and the worship for the Jews for that 1,500-year period. Before that, Noah and the days of patriarchy, father rule period, some 2,500 years. Well, you come down to the church. The principle doesn't change. God is still speaking to us. Only now he speaks us to his, through his Son. And we have it in the New Testament of the Christ, the last will and testament of the Christ. God, who at sundry times and in divers manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, and in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. And that's what we have in the New Testament of the Christ. You know, Jesus promised his apostles, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things. Well, he did or he didn't. And bring all things to your remembrance. He did or he didn't. Whatsoever I've said unto you. I believe Christ kept his promise. And I believe that the apostles, as the ambassadors of the court of heaven, baptized in the baptismal measure of the Holy Spirit, enabling them to do what was necessary after Christ left this earth, along with the gift of prophecy through the laying on of hands to men like James, who was not an apostle, and Luke, who was not an apostle, gave us the Bible that we hold in high esteem because it's the final revelation of God to man and it's the complete revelation of God to man, 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. We have in our hands one of the greatest blessings that could possibly be on this earth. You know, we had nothing to do with it getting here. God has always done for man what man could not do for himself. What a favor God did for us and giving us the divine volume. We take it for granted all too often. We neglect it far too much. But yet, think about it. We couldn't do it. We couldn't provide it. There is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. We couldn't manage. But God did it for us. Jesus, according to the Apostle Matthew, inspired of the Holy Spirit, promised to build his church, Matthew 16 and verse 18. And in this particular passage, he assures us that the Holy Spirit would deliver the divine pattern. That's what we just read. But that's not the only time he said that. Again, he promised, howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. Well, I can say it again, he did or he didn't. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. And he will show you things to come, John 16, 13. Now, both those passages from John are said by Jesus to the apostles relative to their work. I tell you that the early church well understood that. For on the day the church started, the scripture plainly says, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and in fellowship and breaking of bread, Acts 2:42. They knew how Jesus was putting his will on this earth. They knew it involved the apostles. And they spake as the Spirit gave them utterance, which had been promised to them by Jesus himself. So on that first Pentecost day following the resurrection of Christ, for the first time the full gospel, the complete gospel, was delivered. And again I say, the apostles spake as the Spirit gave them utterance, Acts 2:4. So this book was safeguarded in its revelation and preservation by the Holy Spirit. The divine pattern is kept for us, and it's given to us incorruptible. It's up to us to study it honestly. And as we are ordered to preach the word, be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, and exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. That's our duty. We can do it. And the church is preserved and the word of God is presented to all men. And as we're also taught in such passages as Jude 3, we're to defend the faith. We're to stand up for it. In speaking of the revelation of the gospel, the Apostle Paul asserted, but God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit, the us there being the apostles. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. In effect, what he's saying is, the third person of the Godhead is God. He's the revealer of the mind of God, and because he's God, he knows what God thinks. Then he wrote, which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth. The King James has it this way, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. 1 Corinthians 2:10 through 13. The American Standard 1901 translated it to combining spiritual things with spiritual words. If you want to be spiritual, you'll have to go find the spiritual words to tell you how to be spiritual. Well, a righteous man is one who, John says, who does righteousness. But all of God's commandments are righteousness, Psalms 119, verse 172. There's never been a righteous man on this earth that did not keep the commandments of God. That's how a man's made righteous. So therefore, I would expect from those who denigrate the New Testament as a divine infallible pattern to also make light of commandment keeping. I do not know where they ever conjured up that idea. How am I going as a free moral agent to make myself in the likeness of Christ when I don't apply, that is, obey the commandments of my Lord? I wish somebody would show me in either the Old or New Testaments where God looks down upon a person and makes light of them for keeping his commandments. It's right the opposite. And yet some very well dressed and sophisticated looking fellows with a line of degrees behind their name will tell you that's not right. Well, whatever they say, if I'm going to accept it, better be according to the pattern. It's amazing to me how many times people have their minds changed because somebody just asserts something. They just assert it. They don't prove it. Yet we're taught to prove all things, hold fast that which is good. 1 Thessalonians 5:21. I can assert a lot of things. You're ugly and your dog is too. Well, I may be right. But I got to prove it. That means I've got to have a standard on what's ugly and what's not. Well, I make light of that to draw and make a point. Don't just accept what people say. I don't care what they appear to be. I don't care whether in your family, out of your family, what kind of education they have or no education. If it does not fit what this book says, and God said you can understand it if you want to, then don't follow it. It must be according to the pattern, the divine blueprint. Paul has given us this sober warning to follow the pattern. He said, "For we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry. Ye are God's building, according to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder. I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon." Then he makes this marvelous statement. "For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ." 1 Corinthians 3:9 through 11. Consider these words. "Ye are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building, fitly framed together, groweth unto a holy temple of the Lord. In whom ye also are builded together for a habitation of God through the Spirit." Ephesians 2:19-22. Each individual honestly hears and understands the gospel. 1 Corinthians 15:1-4. There Paul rehearses with the Corinthians what he preached to them that caused them to become Christians, because God's located his power to salvation in the gospel message. Romans 1:16. They heard it and they obeyed it and they became Christians, nothing more, nothing less, nothing else. Members of the church you read about in your own Bible. The one Jesus built and purchased with his blood, of which he is head and to which he adds all those he saves. What is being said here by Paul is simply this. The pattern is here and we must follow it. How can you have the church in every generation if you're just going to do it any way you want to do it? You know, there have always been two different approaches to how you study the Bible. Fundamentally, two different approaches. One says that you can do whatever is not expressly forbidden. The other says you must do only what is authorized in the words of the New Testament. Well, you realize that it's not expressly forbidden to kiss the Pope's toe. You find anywhere in the New Testament where a Christian is forbidden from kissing the Pope's toe. You cannot do so. But you have limitations in the way words authorize anybody to do anything. Go to a certain store, you could name it, and buy me a short loaf of bread. I don't care who made the bread, just buy me a short loaf of bread. Is that difficult to understand? That's what I want, and you want to please me, so you listen and understand the words. That's what I've authorized you to do, if you want to please me. Then you come back a few minutes later, and you have a can of Diet Coke. Is that difficult to understand that you did not do as I authorized you to do? And we do that with everything we have to do with in life. Sometimes we tell our children, that's not what I told you to do. I don't know what you would do to the child, and he would respond as Lutheran denominational world has responded, you didn't say not to do it. But when you told them what to do, at least the what, then everything that didn't fit the what, they're not to do. I was studying with a man many, many years ago, and we were talking about mechanical instrumental music. And he was wanting to say, well, that's all right. It doesn't make any difference one way or the other. In fact, what he was trying to do was say, we come there, that's all right. That's the way you do it. We'll go along with you. Well, a lot of my brethren think that would have been fine with them. But truth of the matter is, he didn't believe that the kind of music God wants in worshiping Him in spirit and in truth is authorized, and in that authorization is specified in the words of the New Testament. Well, the man was smoking a pipe, or had, and there was a book or something. Something else up here on the shelf. And I asked him, would he hand me whatever that was? And he did. And I said, well, why didn't you hand me your pipe? And you know what he said? That's not what you said you wanted. But it seems that when God expresses His thoughts on words on our own level of understanding, we don't have that attitude. We just think we can give Him anything that suits us, feel good about it, and He'll like it. You know, that was settled when it came to the worship back in the patriarchal age, the very beginning of it, the worship of Abel and the worship of Cain. They both knew what God said and what He wanted in worship. Now, both worshiped. But when it came to specifying what God wanted offered, only Abel did it, not Cain. In Hebrews 11, in the great chapter on faithful activity, Hebrews 11:4 makes it clear that by faith Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. You know, it'd be interesting to watch folks who are working for Pepsi to be seen drinking a Coke. Do you realize they can get themselves in trouble for that with their own company, and they do things like that? But see, you give God anything He wants, or you want, and it's not supposed to make Him any difference because you were sincere in offering it and you had a good thought in your mind toward God. But that's not the way the book works. It's not the way you work, and it doesn't work that way in government, business, or your own home. Words have meanings. There are generic words and there are specific words. And if we care anything about the authority of the person who speaks those words to us involving what we do, then we respect and we comply with those words. Make all things according to the pattern. Paul wrote to Timothy, hold the pattern of sound doctrine or sound words, which thou hast heard of me in faith and love, which is in Christ Jesus. 2 Timothy 1 verse 13. Do you know there never would have been an apostasy if everybody that heard or believed what Timothy received from Paul had followed it? There would have been. Somebody had to decide, I think we can change on this. Notice the emphasis he gave this. In all things showing thyself a pattern of good works. In doctrine showing uncorruptness, gravity, sincerity, sound speech that cannot be condemned. Titus 2, 7 through 8. Well, you know, if everybody would do that, no one would ever apostatize. No one would ever flounder or fall away. Sound speech is necessary to fulfill the pattern. And again, the inspired apostle said, "But speak thou the things which become sound doctrine," Titus 2:1. Paul further charged that an elder, listen, that an elder, a shepherd of the flock, must. Ken, did you say something about must and let and all that this past Wednesday night? Must be adept in holding fast the faithful word as he hath been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and to convince the gainsayers. Titus 1 and verse 9. Notice how zealously Paul guarded the pattern of the gospel. "I marvel that ye are soon removed from him that called you into the grace of God unto another gospel," literally the Greek, "a gospel of a different kind from what I preached to you when I came there, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed." Galatians 1:6 through 8. Now, what would you think after reading those words and understanding them that God thinks about people who want to deviate from the pattern of sound words? Why was Paul so firm about this? Well, listen, he also wrote this in Galatians 1:11 and 12. "But I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after man. For I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by revelation of Jesus Christ." That's why he could say to the Philippians, "I'm set for the defense of the gospel, of the pure pattern of sound doctrine." Philippians 1 and verse 17. His blueprint had to be faithfully followed without addition, subtraction, or alteration. And that's the way it's right, can't be wrong. And when you begin to adopt in the churches a different view from what I'm setting forth here, then you're going to have changes come. So however fast they come, I don't know. But they'll deviate and the church will apostatize in a matter of time. So the question I ask myself, what should be my state of mind, my attitude, my outlook, my perspective toward all who refuse the divine pattern, the infallible blueprint? Well, it seems to me that the pattern itself tells me what I ought to have, what view I ought to have toward folks who will do this. "Whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. He that abideth in the doctrine hath both the Father and the Son. Any man comes to you and brings not this doctrine, neither receive him into your house, nor bid him Godspeed. For he that biddeth him Godspeed is a partaker of his evil deed." 2 John 9 through 11. Question, is that hard to understand? Is that really hard to understand? Well, John was the apostle of love. Being the apostle of love, he knew that love always leads one to obey God's commandments. And there is no sort of love that will excuse you from disobeying God or from obeying God. Not only are we to follow the pattern of sound words which God has given, but we're also to withdraw from all who do not hold that pattern. That keeps the church pure. It keeps the church as people who follow the pattern, who love the pattern, who will always say with all honesty and activity, "Give me the Bible, star of gladness gleaming, to cheer the wanderer alone in tempest tossed." We'll always in all honesty and integrity be able to sing that because we mean it and we live it. Not only are we to follow the pattern of sound words which God has given, but we're also to withdraw then from these who do not. That's a sad thing. But the Lord shed his blood to purchase the church. And should the members let it get polluted by members who do not respect the authority of God's word or who do not care about holding steadfastly to the divine pattern? If we condone their actions, we then become partakers of their evil deeds and opposing, which they are, the pattern of sound words that are from God. Ignoring or rejecting this divine pattern that God has given to his church, his gospel, his organization, his worship, the mission of the church, has given rise to all manner of pernicious and devious innovations. God covered it all, 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, James 1 verse 25. When it comes down to the pattern for life and you have a man, God tells a man how to live. When he marries and becomes a husband, he tells him what a husband's to be. And when he becomes a father, he tells him how a father is to live. And so with the woman, the wife and the mother. And so with the boy, the son and the brother. And the girl, the daughter and the sister. It governs how to be a friend and even how to be an enemy. And how we're to deal with one another as brothers and sisters in the great church of the living God, the family of God. It tells us how to be citizens of the kingdom of God, the church. It tells us even how to live as citizens of this country and be as we ought to be, because we understand God's design and purpose of civil government. Everything that we are to be in order to save our souls, and in so doing glorify Jehovah God Almighty, is found in the New Testament pattern, 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. Our duty is to take the attitude Paul taught to Timothy. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. That's the way it's right and can't be wrong. And it will guarantee you to hear on the day of judgment, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter ye into the joys of thy Lord." This is just the way it works. There's no use trying to figure any other way for it to work. This is just the way it works. It would make so much difference if we would accept the reality of things and face the facts rather than think we can deviate and change either individually or the church as a whole. And God is still going to be happy with us. It just won't work. So Jesus said, "He that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that judgeth him. The words that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day." John 12:48. We as the Lord's church, to be strong, whether we're few in number or great in number, must be because our faith is founded upon the divine pattern, is strengthened by the infallible blueprint, and is always grounded in a "thus saith the Lord." That's the only way that works, no matter what anybody else says or thinks or doesn't think or say. That's the way that'll get you to heaven. So the question I must always ask myself and everybody else, how much do you really want to go to heaven? If it is a great much, and you'll adhere as closely as you possibly can to the divine pattern and all the precepts and principles of truth that have to do with righteousness, and you won't change. No matter what anybody says or doesn't say or how they treat you, you won't change. You'll be stubborn with the infallible truth that you can know whether anybody admits it or not. And you'll do what's right as the Bible defines the right, no matter what anybody else says or doesn't say or doesn't do. Because there's but one way to heaven. It's through Jesus Christ and His gospel. And it does not change. If you're not a Christian this afternoon, why don't you become a Christian like you read of in your own Bible? By believing that Christ is the Son of God, fully repenting of your sins, confessing your faith in Him, being baptized for the remission of sins, and then walking the straight way to heaven by following the divine pattern. As a child of God, if you've deviated from the path of righteousness, some way you've set aside that divine pattern in your life, we humbly ask you to repent of your sins and God's second law of pardon. Come confessing those sins, and we'll pay with you and for you. And the great God of heaven, who loved you and gave His Son to die for you, will forgive you, and you can once again go toward the realms of glory. If you're subject to the great invitation of our Lord, we invite you to come while we stand and sing.